We're heading into the new financial year with a bunch of interesting events coming up for the economy, the election being prime among them. But there's a lot of other things to talk about as well. What would be the growth outlook going into the next year? Is the change in monetary policy stance going to have an impact on that growth outlook? What about inflation? Joining us to talk about all of that and more is Prachi Mishra, Chief India Economist at Goldman. Prachi, thanks so much for taking the time.
My pleasure, Ira.
I'll start with the big picture. What is your outlook going into FY20, both on growth and on inflation?
So, Ira, for FY19, our growth forecast is 7.3%, and for FY20, it's 7.6%. So, we have growth picking up mildly over the course of the year. On inflation, FY19, we are at 3.6%, and FY20, 4.2%.
Okay. So let me pick up on, you know, some of the more interesting stuff beneath the numbers. So inflation in particular, I think, you know, obviously we've all gone through a period where inflation numbers, actuals have been below forecast, whether it's the RBI forecast or the analyst forecast. As things stand right now, is everybody fairly comfortable that this period of low inflation, which has depressed headline inflation, is going to continue? And if so, why?
Ira, this is a very important question. If you look at food inflation, it's declined dramatically. Just to give you a sense of the magnitudes, from 13% to 2% over the last 5 years. So it's a big change. I think a big question facing all of us, the RBI policy makers, analysts, is how much of this is durable and how much of this is likely to come back. Our analysis suggests that one third of the dramatic decline which we've seen is more likely to be durable. And what are these durable factors? These include, for example, so this government has been very proactive in food management, in releasing food grains whenever there's a shortage of supply. They've also been proactive in, you know, taking steps to improve production and productivity of items, for example, pulses. There's also been increased availability of inputs such as fertilizer. So all these factors have contributed to the durability, to the some fraction being more durable. The rest, in our forecast, actually we have food inflation picking up over the course of the year, but still over the year, still remaining below RBI's medium-term target of 4%.
Okay. Can I just ask you a follow-up question on the durable part of this? So this seems to be more supply side rather than demand side, or does it feed back? Because I think the assumption being made when you look at the low food inflation is that it's a sign of rural distress. But if it's mostly supply side driven, then is that the right analysis?
So I think it's a good point. I think in our framework, food inflation is defined as a function of you know, factors which, you know, rural wages, MSP, monsoon. We think of these as more temporary factors, and we look at the residual of the model to get a sense of what the durable factors are. Our guess is the durable factors, which I talked about, are more likely to be supply driven. You know, more demand driven factors like rural wages, which of course, you know, lower rural wage growth is one of the big factors why food inflation has declined dramatically. It's more a cyclical factor. The economy picks up. If the rural wages do better, then we should see food inflation to pick up because of these cyclical factors.
On the core inflation front, what is your analysis? I think, you know, we've all been debating it, although the RBI sort of said that we, you know, legal target is headline, so maybe that's the policy focus. But still, interesting to understand what's going on core, right?
So, you know, if you ask me, I think this whole debate about, you know, headline causes core or core causes headline, to me, this debate is very misplaced. And let me tell you why, a couple of reasons why. Core, you know, in the Indian context, no matter how you stretch the definition, 30 to 40% at most of the headline CPI. Most other countries, it would be 60 to 80% and more likely to be 80%. So it makes more sense. Second, you know, if you think about, you know, why was core inflation introduced and what is the idea behind core inflation? The essential idea is that, you know, you want to you want to have a measure which is which excludes components which are likely to be driven by supply shocks and which are likely to be volatile. Look, in the Indian context, we know that food inflation is determined by both demand and supply. We had, you know, high food inflation because one of the reasons for that was Indians are getting richer, they're eating better, they're demanding more proteins, more micronutrients. So clearly, you know, food is not does not excluding food does not you know follow that criterion of being determined exclusively by supply. Volatility also, you know, food as we know is fairly persistent. When it was high, it was high. When it's low, it's low. So because of these two reasons, you know, food inflation is a very high proportion of the CPI headline. Second, you know, the idea behind core does not apply that much in the Indian context. Okay. And third, as you know yourself mentioned, that you know, RBI governor, I think, said very clearly in the press conference that we are targeting CPI headline inflation. So our view is a bit different, you know, and our approach, in fact, if I may say, is simpler. We look at every component of you know, inflation, of the headline CPI inflation. We look at food, fuel and transport, core, and we take a view on each of these going forward, rather than, you know, worrying about the question of, you know, core is chasing headline or headline is chasing core.
Okay, no, that's a fair point. So then, given your projections, you would be more or less in sync with what the RBI has done, come down, you know, A, back to neutral, B, right. Cut once.
Right. So in terms of inflation forecast, let me say that, you know, our analysis is totally consistent with the RBI in terms of adjusting down our inflation forecast. So we've also successively brought down our inflation forecast. So FY19 inflation forecast is 3.6%, RBI is, I think, 3.7%. Where we differ is FY20. Okay. FY20, our forecast is 4.2%, they are 3.5%. So their direction is actually downwards. We are expecting food inflation to pick up during the course of the year.
Okay. So then you would see what, room for at most one more rate cut, if at all that?
We actually, our published view is on hold for the rest of the year. Okay. And we actually have two hikes, one in Q4 and one in Q1 of 2020.
Okay. Let me switch a little bit to the growth side. I think they pared their forecast for FY20 down a little bit.
Right.
What's your own sense of what's happening on the ground? Because
right.
the high frequency indicators have been very confusing
right.
again, right?
So we have a GS proprietary current activity indicator that is indeed suggesting some slowdown. So end of 2017, we used to be around closer to 8%. So there's been around a 1 percentage point slowdown, and now we are around 7%. So clearly we are seeing some signs of a slowdown. We going forward, our outlook is more positive in the sense we do see some pickup in growth, and that's driven by lower oil prices, and we are also building in some easing of supply constraints, infrastructure bottlenecks, for example, and some confidence building up once the new government takes office, balanced against lower, you know, lower global growth, for example.
Okay. What are the factors that have depressed growth in the last couple of quarters domestically? Is
right.
Financing
right.
and constraints one of them?
So again, it's you know, NBFC. We know that the NBFC issue has been important. It's not actually in our baseline forecast.
Okay.
We've factored it in our downside risk. So we have 12 to 24 basis point downside risks to our baseline growth forecast because of funding issues relating to NBFCs.
Prachi, what do you, you know, we haven't spoken after the budget. I know this is an interim budget, so, you know, all numbers sort of have relevance for 3 months, if that. But there is seemingly a trend that, you know, the fiscal consolidation process has sort of flattened out a little bit. We've seen 3 years of misses now.
So let me start by saying that, you know, the interim budget, if you ask me, there was hardly anything interim about it. I think it had significant policy announcements.
Yeah.
So let's look at FY19, FY20, and then maybe I can tell you a little bit how we believe in those numbers. To begin with, FY19, clearly the highlight, as you know, was shortfall in GST collection, 0.5% of shortfall in GST. I think the government has been fairly candid and transparent in showing that shortfall. How did they make up that shortfall so that they were exactly on, you know, on target? So just, you know, FY19 revised estimate. The target is, so the revised estimate assumption is 3.37% of GDP, vis-a-vis what was budgeted was 3.33% of GDP.
Yeah.
So I would not say that there's a slippage with respect to the budget assumption. We can talk about the slippage when I go to FY20, but FY19, 0.5% shortfall in GST collection. How did they make it up? I think three ways. I think there's fairly robust assumptions on direct tax collection. Second, customs revenue, which indeed have been doing well. And third, interestingly, if you look at gross tax revenues, they actually show a shortfall of relative to the budget estimate of 0.2% of GDP. Mm. However, the net tax revenue, there's no shortfall. So there's a cut in the share going to the states. Mm. And this is a bit puzzling that, you know, how is that worked out? But maybe there has been some discussion with the states on this issue. Mm. So FY19, you know, short, and our view on FY19 revised estimates is that 0.5% of GDP shortfall in GST collection is still ambitious. Okay. To have the center's GST collection to keep the shortfall to 0.5% of GDP still requires significant intensification of tax collection, GST tax collection, in the last 3 months of the year. That said, I think how they make up for the shortfall, I think direct tax revenues have been doing well, customs have been doing well, and state share, I think that's something that has to be decided between the center and the states. On FY20, I think your argument applies more, that it's applicable. There'll be a new budget in FY20, which will come in July, and that will be, that has to be passed by the parliament.
Okay. So I think one of the, critiques that was very commonly spoken of in the days after the budget was that there's too much sort of money being borrowed, too much spending being pushed off to public sector balance sheets, FCI, etc. Any thoughts on how you would approach that as a share of overall, savings that it's taking away, or any other?
So, of course, if you look at GFS, government finance statistics of the IMF, the international best practice is to have the public sector borrowing requirement, which would include the federal government, which is center, and the states, and public sector enterprises. I think we can talk about the center, which we did in the budget, and the budget has a fiscal deficit for FY20. It has a fiscal deficit target. It's flat. It's not, of course, confirmed to the FRBM, but it's flat relative to FY19. For the states, I think we still have to see. They are budgeted for 2.6% of GDP. That's perhaps ambitious. Even if we assume that they are 3.1% of GDP, which is last year's number, again, they would be flat. So the budget would be center plus states would be fiscally neutral. The question is, these public sector undertakings and what their balance sheets look like. And there, actually, my view is it's hard for us to actually guess those numbers, what the balance sheets look like. And that is something on which official numbers have to be there. And this is something which the Finance Commission can look into, and perhaps is already looking into. I think that as analysts, it's hard for us to guess what the public sector enterprises' balance sheets are looking like.
Okay. I think the concern was that so they do give out those numbers of resources that are being raised on the public sector balance sheet. Right. The concern was that the capex that should have been there on the government's balance sheet is getting pushed. But at an aggregate, my question to you as an economist, how would you analyze that, even if it were to be happening?
Right. I think the capex is definitely, the Indian budget, the Indian government budget, the central government at least, is really skewed towards current spending. Mm-hmm. Current spending is 7 to 8 times that of capital spending. And in fact, this budget has even, one of the ways in which it has offset some of the spending on, for example, the farm income support program is through lower capex. So capex was like 1.7% of GDP in FY19, and it's even, budgeted to go down to 1.6% of GDP in FY20. So I think that's an important issue. Of course, some of it is being, some of the capital spending is being done through public sector enterprises. So from growth point of view, that's actually good, because then you're not reducing capital spending overall. Sure. And to the extent if you're increasing the efficiency of capital spending in the budget, that's also plus from a growth perspective. Of course, from a fiscal accounting and best practices perspective, you would rather have everything in the budget, and you would have a public sector borrowing requirement rather than just the fiscal deficit.
Sure. We haven't spoken about the big headline announcement in the budget. How do you begin to analyze this, income support scheme? Right. It'll be very tough to get numbers as to what the growth impact will be, or, what the inflation impact will be. But what are the areas that you would want to look into?
So, Ira, I think, again, my view is you cannot look at the income support, farm income support program in isolation. If you have to look at the budget in totality, FY19 and FY20, and if you have to see whether there's a net fiscal impulse in the budget. For FY19, the spending on the farm income support program is 0.1% of GDP. 2,000 rupees transferred to about 120 million farmers by the end of March. Interestingly, despite this increase, the budget does not show an increase in expenditure vis-a-vis the budgeted. The RE does not show an increase in expenditure relative to the BE. And how they've done this is basically they've reduced 0.1% of GDP elsewhere, and where it appears as an offset is in GST compensation to states. Mm-hmm. That has been reduced by 0.1% of GDP. Perhaps state GST collection are doing better, and they need to be compensated less. So FY19, relative to the budget target, it's actually not, expenditure has not deviated. The fiscal also is a little bit lower relative to FY18. FY18 was 3.5, and FY19 is 3.37% of GDP. So it's consolidation. Of course, I think you've pointed this. There's slippage, but the slippage is vis-a-vis the FRBM target. Mm. But sure, that is not new to this year. This is third successive year when the budget, either the budget or the outturn, is deviated from the 3% of GDP given by the FRBM. Okay. For FY20, 0.36% of GDP is the amount for the farm income support program, and there I think clearly they've shown a decline in expenditure, but not by 0.36% of GDP, but lower than that because there's been some offset in capital spending, as we talked about. Capital spending is actually reduced. Okay. And then so there is an expenditure increase in the FY20 budget. How have they kept the fiscal flat despite this increase in expenditure is the assumption on revenues, on GST as well as on direct tax collection. Two things. One, I think we have to see, what the new budget July comes and what the new budget is looking like. And number two, I think there is no, again, through the budget, there is no net fiscal impulse. Whether this is credible or not, whether GST collections can actually increase by that much, I think first of all we have to wait for the FY19 outturn before trying to guess whether the GST collections by FY20 actually make sense. Because if now I think the center's GST collection, the average run rate is 455. Hmm. You have for FY20 the average, if you want the GST collections to go up by 0.2 percentage points of GDP, you have to increase that run rate to 633 billion INR. So there's a sharp increase in the GST collection which is needed, and some intensification is already happening. We have to give it some time to see how this pans out.
Okay, and the sort of impact of this, because it's a direct income support on things like certain categories of food, etc., that's probably too early to tell right now because we don't have any experience to go by.
Right. Again, I think that's I would like to look at more in a general equilibrium sense in the context of net fiscal impulse.
Okay.
Because if there are offsets on other items, that's going to have corresponding effects in the opposite direction.
Okay.
Whether the effect through the spending is higher than through some of the offsets is hard to say at this point.
Sure. Just a last question then, as we go into the next few months, what are some of the other aspects that you're watching out for, in terms of impact on the Indian economy? Of course, elections being prime among them, I'm sure, but beyond that.
I think we are watching inflation very closely. I think tomorrow is the CPI print, and we'll be looking at it. The direction is important. Both the magnitude as well as the direction is important. Growth, of course, whether the slowdown is really a slowdown, whether it's likely to be sustained, whether it gets deeper or the economy picks up, whether it's just some of the noise which we are picking in our current activity indicator, something we are going to watch out. Fiscal is, of course, the outturn on GST collection and outturn on fiscal overall is something we watch very closely. And finally, the external environment now is looking good with oil where it is. If that changes, I think a lot of things will change in the Indian economy.
All right, Prachi, lovely talking to you. Thanks so much for your time.
My pleasure, Ira.
Thank you.